He's an expert in sustainability field, working with PRD Associates since long. And I request him to introduce today's key speaker, Sandeep Neeman, please.
Hello. Thank you so much, Hardik Bhai, for the introduction. Hello.
Yes, Gauru, you are audible.
Yeah, audible? Okay. Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you so much, Hardik Bhai, for the introduction. Hello, everyone. I am Gauru Jain. I am regional manager for PDA and working with Dharkar sir. I am having 7 years of experience in green building and sustainability. So today is very a good session of subject which is very near close to my heart, fundamentals of sustainability. So before we start, before I introduce you to our guest lecturer today, let me give you some glimpse on the sustainability. Why it is so important? We are a country of 1.35 billion and we are keep on increasing, right? And you know, 32% of Indian's population lives in urban areas. And while 10% the built up area is increasing annually since last decade. So we can say that 1.35 billion peoples and we are keep on increasing. And the population and the total built up area, the concrete structure is also keep on increasing, right? 700% increase in commercial energy consumption in last 4 decades, and it is keep on growing. So you can see that how much energy demand has been increased since last 3 to 4 decades. In 1950 to 2020, in 70 years, things have changed completely. Energy consumption in India will grow up to 3 times of current consumption by 2030. That is one prediction that this is going to be increased by 3 times by the 2030. So, you know, as we have seen, there is a shortage of average 225 million liter water per day in major Indian cities. You must have heard that in Delhi running out of water, Shimla running out of water, and in South Africa, there is one city that is completely run out of water. So the things are getting worse. And in 2020 itself, we are witnessing the challenges which the humanity is facing. Now, building, if you see the building growth forecast in the country, that is currently it is 34% and yet to be built that is 66%. So we are saying that now it is whatever we have constructed is just 34%. That is 660 million square meter is going to be constructed. So that is what the survey says. So that indicates that we are continuously going to increase our energy consumption, our concrete, our steel structure, our requirements are keep on going while we have a shortage of water and other things at this stage itself. So that is where we have to identify some path. How do we deal with this? Because we have very limited resources. Resources are not increasing as our population is increasing. We are increasing by hundreds and 200 times, but our resources are keep on depleting. So to balance that, we have to think something, and we cannot decrease our demand. Because since population is increasing, so we cannot drastically reduce our demand. And since our natural resources are also, you know, we cannot increase the natural resources. We cannot increase the natural resources, whatever available to us by the nature. So we have to think of something which is termed as sustainability. How do we sustain in the scenario? So that is what the sustainability is all about. I have just to give the brief details. Then Ms. Sandeepani Vajay will take it further. So let me introduce to Ms. Sandeepani Vajay, our today's guest lecturer. She holds a master's degree in structural engineering. She is the vice president of Earthonomic Engineers Private Limited, a sustainability consultancy firm from Chennai. She is an IGBC accredited professional actively working towards sustainability in Amravati region and on various green projects in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. She has been contributing to IGBC Amravati chapter as a core committee member and handling awareness programs and IGBC student chapters. She is also the program chair of ISRAE Vijayawada sub-chapter, creating awareness related to green buildings in different government organizations, educational institutes and other chapters. She is also an ECBC expert and empaneled ECBC third-party assessor in Andhra Pradesh. So I would like to invite Sandeepani Vajayji. I'll hand it over to you all up to you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gaurav. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Thank you so much, Mr. Gaurav. And I think you have already reduced my efforts to explain why there is a need for green buildings and sustainability. It's high time for sustainability. Thank you so much for that one. And good evening, everyone. This is Sandeep Nivache. As Mr. Gaurav have introduced, I'm Vice President of Earthonomic Engineers, and I'm also a program chair for Vijayawada sub-chapter. So most likely, I'm very much connected to ISHRAE. So I'm a family of ISHRAE as well. And I feel very delighted to be a part of this program associating with the ISHRAE Ahmedabad chapter. This is my first time out of South. I've given programs for South, but never did any program for North or East or West zones. So I feel very good to be a part of this. And I quickly would like to start this session without giving any introduction because it was already covered. So I think I'll skip that part. And I'll share the screen. Yes. Is my screen visible?
Yes. Your screen is visible.
Yes. Yeah.
Right. So the fundamentals of sustainability. So whether it is a green building or sustainable building, it is not something different. Sustainability or a green thing is nothing but one and the same. So you need not get confused about green building and a sustainable building. Okay. First, I like more interactive sessions, but since this is a digital platform, I choose to ask you some poll questions, so that it will be more of interactive. And I think most of the attendees will be students today, and maybe few people who are very much interested in sustainability to know about sustainability and all. So I'll try to keep it very simple and in layman language to help you out to understand what is a green building or what are all the parameters or specifications or something that requires for a green building. So to keep it very short, just minimize the screen. Okay. Sir, again, someone put on the poll question. So just observe the screen for a while. There are five buildings on the screen. So let me start with the questions. And you can expect a question wherever there is a blue mark, blue star in that particular slide, you can expect the question. Sir, can someone launch the poll or can make me the host so that I can launch the poll?
Rajendra Bhai.
Ma'am, you are host.
Okay, sir. So just observe the buildings on the screen. So there are five buildings. Which of these buildings do you think are green or sustainable buildings? So I'll launch a poll. Okay. Oh, all the questions are attached in one poll itself. So I request you to answer for first question alone now. Just first question alone. Just answer for the first question alone. Which of these buildings are green or sustainable buildings? You can give one or more answers, no issues. You'll have an option. You can just type for the option. Are the attendees able to type it?
Yes.
Yes.
We can select the options as well.
Yes, please. Just first question alone. You need not launch, you need not answer all the questions. Just first question alone. Are the attendees able to answer? End the poll. I'm ending the poll. Unfortunately, I don't see anyone. Mr. Gaurav, I think
is I it think visible there is a Yeah. I think you can raise one more time. There was some issue. I think I have also tried to put one answer. Can you please raise the poll again?
Yes.
Yeah, please.
Is it visible now? Or you can also answer in the chat box.
Right, I guess chat box would be better.
Maybe the questions are entered all together. I'll end the poll.
Right.
So please use the chat box. So I can see A, D, B, E, A, C, and D, E. Okay. Right. Many of them were saying a lot of things like A, B, C, D. Most of the options are A, C, and D. I see that most of the options are A, C, and D. Yes. Okay, let us stop here for now. And I would like to confirm the answer that it is all. All these buildings are green buildings. I'll tell you why. So this building is obvious that you can see that it is a green building because you can see a lot of greenery, solar panels, wind tower and all. So you might have thought that this is a green building. Yes, that is true. This is a green building. And C is a very ancient building, which even I have went there once. It is Lotus Mahal in Hampi. It is a very old and architectural building. Like we think, do you think that olden people doesn't know anything about green buildings and all? Then it is really not, I mean, like it is them who have taught us how a green building should be. That architectural elements and all, if you can see, there are a lot of openings and you can see the top, like the roofs are not exposed to a lot of heat and there is a lot of airflow inside, too many openings and all. So the architecture is very different and it is a green building. And this one, you can see that there is a lot of greenery. So most of them might have thought that this is a green building. Of course, the envelope is covered with greenery. This is a green building, of course. But coming to B, you see, it seems like it is a building with total glass facade. Of course, it is a building with glass facade, but this is not glass. This is BIPV. BIPV in the sense it is building integrated photovoltaic, that is solar. You know, solar panels, right? We put our solar panels on the terrace and all. So now the latest technologies are emerging and you can use your facade, your glass facade to be the solar power generation unit. So this is a building which have implemented such kind of technology. So this building is generating a lot of renewable energy in the sense solar power. They are generating a lot of solar power through this facade. And E. This is perfectly a glass, that is right. This is a glass building, but this is one of the LEED platinum rated buildings. Just a second, please. So this is one of the LEED platinum rated buildings in the world. LEED platinum rated in the sense it is highest rated building. It is highest rated building in the world. So this is also a green building. So the perspective at which you look at a green building is very different. It is all about the combination of many things. It is not about just the greenery or it is not about just what are the materials they are using and all. It is about everything. You have to take everything into consideration. So you will understand why I said that this building is a green building. You will understand when I keep saying one and when I keep going forward in the presentation. So here I have another question for you. I'll ask a direct question here. It would be a direct question. So there are a lot of different traditional housing styles in India. Like if you can see this is in Kerala, this is in Kashmir, this is in Meghalaya and Rajasthan, Gujarat. In that areas, you have these kind of buildings like the bottom one. So why do you have a lot of building styles in India itself? Can you tell me why is it? Is it because of the traditional or the vastu that we follow? Or is it because of the culture or the kind of lifestyle we have? Or it is because of the climatic factors do we have or everything? What do you think? please use the chat box for this. The question is here, the second question. Just refer to the second question. Just refer to the second question and use your chat box to answer. Climatic conditions. Rajendra sir, can you please mute? Okay, many of the people are saying that it is climatic conditions. You say that climate and culture. You say that everything.
Just a moment. Rajendra, your phone is not mute.
No, sir.
Let me call him. Just a minute.
It's okay. Email, I'll check it. Climatic conditions. Most of them say that climatic conditions. Few say that culture. And few are saying that all the above. Okay, I'm ending the call. Okay. I would like to say that the answer is not all the above. It is because of the climatic parameters. Because even the culture or tradition or vastu, whatever it is, all these things have evolved from the climate only. Based on the climate only, we have developed all the kind of lifestyles, designs and everything so that we will have comfort to live. So it is all about the climatic. So next, as Gaurav sir was saying, water, earth and everything we are deploying the elements of nature. You all know that there are five elements of nature. Sir, can someone call Rajendra sir and tell him to mute?
Ma'am, I'm calling him. Just a minute. I already called. His call is going on, but
maybe am I host? If I'm host, maybe I can directly.
You are host, so you can do him mute. No issue, ma'am.
Yes. I'm doing it. Right. Okay.
Perfect.
There are five elements of nature, that is fire, earth, water, air and metal. Without these things, it is very difficult. These are the gifts given by the nature to us. And what do I say about green building is nothing but preserving or protecting or conserving such kind of elements. All the five elements of nature is called a green building. A building which can that can eliminate the negative impacts on your environment or conserve the natural resources can be referred to as a green building. If you can see, earth is nothing but the site which you are handling. And this is the materials that will go into our building. We will use hell a lot of materials in the building. So I'm talking about that materials, that is metal. And this is energy. Energy in the sense fire. The element I'm talking about is fire and the energy. And water, obviously you know that water is need of our now. And indoor environmental quality, this is about the air. We spend most of our time, like 70 to 75% of our time in the indoors, whether it is office space or whether it is a residential space, you keep staying indoors most of the time. So it is very important that your environment, which is there inside your building, should be healthy so that we'll have less impacts on our health as well. So now I have another question for you. I'll tell you why I've asked this question after I have answered this slide. So who plays a major role in planning a green building? If you have to plan a green building since the beginning, who is the one that plays a very vital role, that is very major role in green building design? Is it an architect or a civil engineer who executes the project, or architect who designs the project, or MEP who designs the energy related things, or a green building advisor, that is a sustainability consultant like us, green building advisor who keeps on advising what to do and all, or everyone? What could be the answer? Please use the chat box. All the above, all the five. Yes, all the five. All the above, five, 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 five. Thank you so much. And this is very good that I've seen this option, all the above, and it is way more than I've expected from the students or the attendees. So the answer is everything. Even the architect or engineer or MEP or green building advisor, we all have to work together. So it is an integrated design approach. Integrated design approach in the sense, since the beginning, architect will design your building, will plan your building, and civil engineer, he has to execute your building. MEP, that services are very important. You know how important the electric, mechanical and all these services are. So architect can't design something which will not integrate with the MEP. And civil engineer, he should be aware how important it is to implement that architectural and these particular MEP elements into that building properly to make it a green building. And green building advisors, they of course, from the starting, they will check the norms and they will be advising all these people. So everything should be an integrated approach. Everyone has to sit together and plan it together, because each and every parameter, like the design will impact on the MEP. The MEP might impact on the design sometimes, like it might not be efficient if the architectural design is not good. And likewise, you have a lot of things that goes into our building. So every one of these have to work together to get a perfect planning for a green building. Why did I tell you this one is because now I think most of the people who attended this session must be from mechanical department or electrical department. Ishray, in the sense, mostly the people from mechanical segment will be there. So what I thought is, it is very important for them to know about a green building as well. They can't say that a green building is something which is related to civil or architectural people, but not the mechanical. Here, MEP plays a major role in green building. So it is important for everyone to understand what is a green building. That is the reason why I have asked that question, and I'll directly get into the contents now. So the sustainable site, I'm talking about the site now, earth. How can we handle this? So topsoil preservation. Why do we have to do the topsoil preservation? I'll tell you why. What is a topsoil first? Topsoil in the sense, the top 15 to 20 centimeters of soil. That is, if you can see the image in the left side, the top 15 to 20 centimeters of the soil is called topsoil. That is very important because that particular soil, that layer will have all the nutrients and minerals present in it. 90% of the nutrients and minerals are present in topsoil only. Below the topsoil, they will lack some minerals and nutrients which are required for the plant growth. And do you know what? The inch or inch layer of topsoil will take 100 years to form. So it is very easy to remove the topsoil, but it is not very easy to get that topsoil back. It is very difficult. So it is a mandatory thing that has to be done if it is a greenfield. Greenfield in the sense, which is not a constructed area or reconstruction or something. See, if you can see the picture, you'll understand. If it is a greenfield, it is important that you have to take that 15-20 centimeters of soil and stockpile it. Stockpile in the sense, you can see the picture here. Topsoil stockpiling, it is called topsoil stockpiling. You have to put it at one side, and even if the vegetation grows on it, that's okay, not a problem. You can use this particular soil for landscape after the construction. And preserve, or you can conserve the natural topography. Natural topography in the sense, the site which is not disturbed. Even within the site, you'll have some spaces where you need not disturb, or you need not excavate or do something. And if there are any particular elements like natural ponds or natural rocks in that particular site, just try to avoid disturbing that particular things, because they are naturally made. They are very valuable. So we have to try to prevent. We have to prevent disturbing that kind of things. And if there is any plant, there are trees now. There is a technology called tree transplantation. If there are huge trees which are coming in the way of the plant, and you have to cut down the trees, then there is something called tree transplantation. Of course, it is a bit costly process, but latest technologies are there. You can try. You can just remove it from there, and you can put it in your site, within your site, or you can also transport it to another site. And here you'll have another question. What we recommend in green buildings is you have to choose when you're doing the landscape or plantation. We recommend you to choose the native species or drought tolerant species. And we also ask you to go for more flowering trees or fruit bearing plants, because I'll ask you a question. So you will only tell me why is it because. So the question here is, I'll launch a poll. You can refer to the question. Please look into the fourth question. Native, why do we have to put native and drought tolerant species? So is it because they can survive under harsh climate, or is it because they have less water consumption, that is we need not put more water, or is it because of the biodiversity, or to produce the food? What is the reason? What is the reason that we have to go for native and drought tolerant species and the fruit bearing or the flowering plants? Please use the chat box. Chat box, please. Why I don't see any answers? All the above. Okay. Oh, now I see most of the people there.
In poll also, we can submit, Sandeepni, if you can.
Yes, see. Yes. Now they are giving it. Previously, yeah. It was not there. Now
yeah,
they are.
Yeah. It is there. It is there. Yeah.
That's good. So most of them are saying that all the above. So in chat box, we are saying it is biodiversity, temperature tolerance. Okay, I can see that most of the answers are all the above. Okay. So I'll tell you. Of course, all the answers are right, but the major thing is biodiversity. The major thing is biodiversity. To some extent, all the answers are right. The major thing is biodiversity, because it is this earth is not just for human beings. There are also other creatures which are living in this earth. We are disturbing a lot of forest areas. We are cutting down the trees and a lot. So there is no scope for small animals which are depending on these plants or flowers or something like that. If you take the butterflies and dragonflies, all these things, many insects are there which will depend on the flowering trees. And fruit-bearing trees, there are squirrels many birds are also dependent on that particular things. Producing about food, of course, yes, for us, but it is also important to just leave some space for other beings also to live. And if you can see the pictures in this one, I have given cross mark to one picture and tick mark to another picture. Mr. Gaurav, can you see my pointer? Is my mouse pointer visible? Mr. Gaurav?
Yes, visible, ma'am.
My pointer is visible, no? Wherever I'm moving the pointer?
Yes.
Okay, sir. So, I said this is wrong and this is right. Do you know why did I say that? Any idea? Can someone drop the answer in the chat box? Why should there not be more lawn, and why should there be more shrubs? It's okay. I don't want to waste a lot of time. So it is good to reduce your lawn area and provide more shrubs and trees, because lawn area, it will not give any support. Like, it is only for aesthetical purpose. It will not serve as a greenery. If you consider it, it is in green color, but it cannot be considered as the proper greenery that we need. That is good for environment. Also, it consumes a lot of water, and there is a lot of maintenance involved in it. And if you go for shrubs and trees, which can give you cover and all, you'll have a very fresh air and all those things in front of your house. So we recommend you to reduce your lawn area and increase the shrubs or trees which you are going to plant in front of your houses or wherever it is. So there are also many innovative plantation ideas like this. Vertical gardens are happening a lot these days. You have indoor plants which will purify the air and all inside your house. And these are some kind of new innovative ideas where there is space constraint. Many people are going for different kind of plantations like this. So heat island effect, I would like to talk about this one for a minute. So heat island effect, this will be a new word for most of them. But this is something which happens in front of our eyes and something which you can feel it yourself every day. So if you consider the urban areas, they are much warmer than the rural areas. That is, if you take the outskirts of your city and your city, you can feel the difference of temperature, especially in the night times. In the night times, the urban areas are much warmer compared to the rural areas. That is because the materials like the concrete or your roads or whatever, all these kind of materials, they will absorb the heat during the day. During the day, there will be sun rays and there will be a lot of heat in the atmosphere. So all these bodies, what they do is they will absorb the heat and they will store the heat. The concrete bodies, your walkways, whichever, even your vehicles. All these materials will have a property to conduct or store the heat. And so they will store the heat. What happens is once the climate starts getting cooled down in the outside, you know that heat flows from higher temperature to lower temperature. So once the temperature starts getting down in the atmosphere, in the outside atmosphere, what happens is all these particular materials which absorb the heat and store the heat now will start releasing the heat into the atmosphere. So what happens is automatically this heat will be trapped and it will make your outside temperatures warm. So that is the reason why you feel that difference between the rural areas and urban areas. This whole effect is called heat island effect. How can we control this heat island effect? There is only one way where you can control this heat island effect. That is, you have to stop the materials from taking in the heat. So that is like if you there is roof and non-roof. Roof in the sense your terrace areas, and non-roof in the sense the areas which are exposed to the sun, which are on the ground, like your roads, walkways, your parking areas, whatever which is there on the surface, your land. So if you want to stop this one, there are two ways where you can do that. One is on the roof. You can plant the trees along the walkways wherever is possible, and you can go with the pavers, like grass pavers or normal pavers. So this will stop heat to an extent, because these trees will help you stop the sun rays touching, hitting the floor directly. And if you consider the roof area, you can go for vegetation on roof. That is the best option. If not, you have another thing, that is you can go for insulation or SRI paint. You have this white paint which you put over your buildings to stop the heat in the top floors. So that is called SRI paint. SRI in the sense solar reflective index paint. So it will reflect the solar heat and it will stop that material from absorbing the heat. You also have tiles for this one. You call them as cool roof tiles. So you can go for any of these things to stop the heat. I can't say that you can stop it completely, but you can reduce it to an extent. And the construction waste management, while construction will use a lot of materials and there will be a lot of waste coming. So it is very important to properly manage this particular construction waste. Like you have to segregate it properly within the site, and you have to either reuse. If it is possible, you can reuse it. Steel scrap and all the concrete debris in the sense, the waste coming from this concrete blocks or something like that. It can be used for refilling something, or timber can be used. Wherever it is possible, you can reuse it. And if there is an excess, you have to properly send it to the vendors. There are vendors who will buy it and recycle it. So you have to send it to the recycling vendors. You should not simply dump it in some other landfills. So to avoid that one, it is very important to follow proper waste management system, construction waste management system. A few other measures that we have to take during the construction are, this is wheel washing. We call it as wheel washing. When the huge vehicles come in and go, there will be a lot of dust. So when they go onto roads again, there will be a lot of dust which is accumulated on the roads. To avoid that one, we'll have something called wheel washing. So here, when the vehicle comes here, the wheels will be automatically washed. This is like if you have any dangerous areas, you have to put the caution marks there in construction areas. And the equipment for a construction workforce is very important. This is watering, dust suppression. We call it as dust suppression. During the construction, If you go to the site, there will be a lot of dust. You can see a lot of dust and you can even feel it. So what we have to do is we have to frequently water the land so that the dust will not raise, the particles will not raise into the air and cause air pollution. Coming to the water. So water main parameter, main mandatory thing that you have to do is rainwater harvesting. You, as Gaurav sir already mentioned, water is very much important now. Water has been exploited in many regions. You know the importance of water now. And so there are other methods where you can store the water, rainwater. You can either go with the collection ponds if you have space and all, like storage tanks, or you can have a storage tanks like this. You can collect that water. Roof water will be mostly fine. There will not be much dust and all, so that you can simply use a filter and reuse this water for some other purpose like washing or something like that. Or percolation. Percolation in the sense you have percolation pits and also borewell injections. Like percolation pit in the sense you'll have a cross section where, I don't know, what do you call it in Hindi? Your rainwater will be collected in one place where there are different layers. Layers of gravel, sand and all, so that the water will percolate into the soil. Because we have all the concrete structures and all. So you have to give them space to percolate into the land so that your water tables will not go down. Injection borewells in the sense, it will be like this. So you will go down by, it's just like bore, water bore. You will just go down by 90 meters or more than that, 90 feet, 100 feet, more than 200 feet. So that the water will directly go into the aquifers. So for this one also, you have to put the layers initially to filter the water. And next, water efficient fixtures. Water efficient fixtures in the sense, the fixtures which will have low flow, like you can see the taps like this. These days, many of them are using taps with this one. This is called as aerator. Aerator, because of this, what happens is the flow of your water fixture will reduce. If this aerator is not there, maybe your flow might be like 10 liters per minute or something like that. But if this particular one is there, it will control the flow which comes out. So it will be around 6 liters per minute or 5 liters per minute. Because the duration that you wash your hand is the same, even if there is an aerator or if it is not there. If you use it for 30 seconds, you are going to waste 5 liters if there is no aerator. And you are going to waste only 2.5 liters if there is an aerator. So that makes a lot of sense. And also technologies are there, like sensor-based fixtures and all are there. They'll have even more good efficiency. Low flow system. Here I have another question for you. So any one of you have seen this, like, I don't know how many of you are aware of this one. And why do we use this? This is called dual flushing system for your commodes, for your Western commodes. In launch, I have given actually, I don't know how many of you know this and how many of you don't know this, but I'll explain you what it is. So there are two flushing systems here. That says that if your flush is liquid flush, that you go to urinals or something, you need not flush the whole water in the tank. You'll have a capacity of tank. If the tank capacity is 10 liters, you need not flush whole 10 liters for liquid flush. It is only useful for solid flush to flush the whole capacity of tank. So if you consider your daily usage, hardly once or twice, and most of the times, whether it is 6 times or 7 times, whatever it is, it will be the liquid flush. So here you can directly save 50% of the water. If you press only one button, only 50% of the water will be flushed. If you press the two buttons, then the total water will be used. So based on the type of flush you need, you can use it like this. So it is directly like 50% water savings if you use it efficiently. And also there are technologies like sensor-based urinals are there, waterless urinals are there, but it depends on the usage also. If you are efficient, you can, it needs some, what do we say, you have to use it properly, otherwise they will not work well. And sewage treatment plant in the sense, this is a plant where you can treat your gray water. Black water is different and gray water is different. Gray water in the sense the water from your toilets that which you bath, not from the flush, I mean not from your commodes. it is from your bathing water or from kitchen, you'll have kitchen water and all. That is called gray water. The black water is something which comes from this commodes and all. That is called as a black water. So we can treat the gray water through sewage treatment plant to a standard where the water is purified. And you can use that particular water for mopping or flushing. Flushing in a sense, the lines from treated water, this thing, tanks can be connected to your commodes again, your western commodes. So that you can use that treated water for flushing, since you don't have to bother about that. We can't use that particular water in kitchen and all. So there is another way for this. You can use it for flushing or laundry or gardening, landscape, mopping, something like that. Phytoremediation is another kind of treating water. Here you will have ponds where you put some plantation, and these special plants, they will purify the water with the roots itself. And the results are very good. This is a very huge topic. I'm just giving you a quick glance. If you want to know more about this, you can Google it and see by yourself. And other few water conservation measures are like water metering. Like energy meters, there are also water meters. So you can see the consumption, what is the water that you are consuming, what is the water, wherever it is possible, wherever there is huge consumption of water, you can put the water meter and see. Even if there are some leakages and all, it is easy for you to identify if there is proper monitoring for it. And this is sprinkler and drip irrigation system. You know these sprinklers, we use it when there is a lawn. This is drip irrigation. These are the pipes which are laid. So you need not water them like this whenever there are also sensor-based systems in this one. So if you use this, there will be holes for these pipes. These are all perforated pipes. So the water will just pass through these. This is very efficient system. You can use very less water. You will not waste the water at all. Next, I'll come to the energy part, which is more important to your mechanical, I mean MEP segment. So here I have another question for you. In the poll, you have this question. I'll just relaunch the poll. So just tell me why should we not use CFC and HCFC? Why CFC and HCFC should be banned? So here, the question is a sixth question. You can answer the sixth question if you can see. Or see, CFCs and HCFC will cause what? Global warming, or greenhouse effect, or ozone depletion, or all of the above. What will they cause? Why should we ban CFC and HCFC? You can use the chat box as well. Carbon footprint, okay. Okay, fine, let's stop it here. Most of them are saying that it is all the above, but I would like to say that it is ozone depletion. It is for ozone depletion. Of course, global warming and greenhouse effects are something which are caused due to this carbon dioxide and all methane, carbon dioxide, nitrous oxides. Greenhouse effect will cause global warming. They're both related. And especially the CFCs, HCFCs and halogens, these will affect the ozone layer. So that is the reason why we have to stop this and use eco-friendly refrigerants like R32, R410 and all these kind of things. There are many more. These are just a few examples of that. And efficient electrical fixtures. In efficient electrical fixtures, most of you know that it is good if you go for 5-star rated instead of 2-star or 3-star rated. Of course, yes. The more the stars are, the more will be the energy saving. And LED fixtures, if you compare the old fixtures and the LED fixtures, LED fixture will give good amount of light, it will sustain for long, and also it will emit less heat. That is also one another parameter. So there will be a lot of energy savings in the lighting if you go for LED fixtures. And there are also certain fans like super fans. You can see super fans these days. These are more efficient. Like if normal regular fan consumes 75 watts, the super fan will consume only 35 watts. But the efficiency is the same for both of them. I mean, the output is the same for both of them. And I'll talk a minute about this one. This is called light pollution. So night time when we put on the lights, there will be something called as light pollution. So we have to reduce that light pollution. If your lighting is like this, if it is facing upward or if it is open like this, then there will be 50% wastage of water and 10% glare, and the efficiency of light is only 40%. I'm talking about external lights, not the internal lights. I'm talking about external lights. External light in the sense which we use in garden or in the premises, road or something like that. So it is very important that your lighting fixtures should be faced downwards. Downwards in the sense you will see on the roads, right? In this picture, you can see here in a corner, it is faced downward. If it is downward, the light beam will not be going here and there, and there will not be light pollution. And also you will be using that light effectively. It will be productive as well. And the most important thing is you're not going to disturb the atmosphere. Night time, there are a lot of birds and all which will be traveling here and there in the night time. So we have to give access for them to live. We should not confuse them, right? If they are going somewhere, they should not feel like whether it is night or whether it is morning, something like that. And you can see the difference. You can feel the difference yourself. If you are in a space, if you are in rural areas or somewhere where there are no lights, you can see the stars very clearly. But if you are in the location on the same day, if you are in another location where there are a lot of lights, you won't be able to see the stars. That is all because of the light pollution. So we have to reduce the light pollution. And these are the sensors. You have occupancy sensors, lighting sensors and all, which will act according to the occupancy, or the lighting sensors will be like, if the lighting lux levels are going down, then they will start acting and then the artificial lights will start operating. Or otherwise, if there is enough light of up to particular lux level, then automatically the artificial lights will be switched off. Even for external lights, these will be useful. Based on the lighting levels, the lux levels of the light, the intensity will be controlled. And there are also many other innovative technologies like cooling systems or heating system. This is called radiant cooling. That is, there will be copper pipes or some PVC kind of pipes laid in the floor or the ceiling or the walls, and it is covered. So this cooling is like, they will pass the cool water or heat water through these pipes, and through radiation, you will get the cooling or heating. Radiation is the parameter where, like, if you have a cool bottle, if you have an ice, bottle of ice, if you put the bottle of ice there and you need not touch it, you just keep your hand just close to that bottle, you will feel the cooling. That particular thing is because of radiation. Even if it is hot, or even if it is some hot bowl, you need not just touch the bowl. You just put your hand close to the bowl and you can feel the heat. That is because of radiation. On the same technology, it will be operating. So the cooling, the radiation which will be coming from these pipes, it will help cool the surfaces. And geothermal cooling or heating is like you lay the pipes into the surface of the earth. Like you'll go down the earth, you'll lay the pipes from the earth so that you know that the water or this earth and all, if it is cool outside, it will be warm inside. It is warm inside, it will be cool outside. So we can use that technology to cool the air or heat the air. These are all very efficient systems. The installation will be costly, but it is very much efficient. And coming to the solar renewable energy, it is not only solar, you have wind energy or I was talking about BIPV before, right? BIPV means building integrated photovoltaic technology. That is nothing but the solar panels which are integrated with the building. So you can integrate it like this. These are all the solar panels which are erected on the facades. So you can use this technology so that you can avoid the glass and also you can produce the energy. Wherever there is space constraint, this is a very good option. And this is biogas plant. If you are having any waste generation and a lot of organic waste, you can use the biogas plant, and from this one, you can generate the gas, which can be used in the kitchen. And building management system is very important. If it is a commercial building, if it is a residential, that is okay. A simple metering will help you out. But if it is a huge commercial building, there will be a lot of parameters that have to be monitored and so that the energy is not wasted. So that is called building management system. you'll have a lot of softwares as well to handle this one. So every consumption can be recorded in that one. Whatever the energy, water, gas, whichever it is, how much elevators are using, lighting consumption, what is the lighting consumption, what is the air conditioning consumption, everything can be checked in this building management system. So coming to the building materials, I'll try to keep it short because you might get confused if I talk a lot about all these things. So first thing is, in materials, it is very important to first reduce the usage as much as possible. Then try to reuse the material. Even if that is not possible, then you can recycle the material. So you have to efficiently use the material which we have extracted from the nature. So also in bricks, there are a lot of classifications in bricks, and there are a lot of materials that you can use for your building envelope. So common bricks, you have sandline bricks, engineering bricks, aerocon blocks, you have fly ash blocks. Based on the type of your building or the amount that you can put in, you can use any kind of these things. And these are all like compared to the common bricks, the fly ash bricks or aerocon blocks. These will be much better because they have less U-value. U-value in the sense of the thermal conductivity, the amount of heat that can be transmitted to through a particular material. So the lesser the U-value, lesser will be the heat that will be coming inside. If you are using low U-value materials for your external walls, then the heat which is coming inside will be less. And concrete, even there are a lot of concrete like geopolymer concrete, glasscrete, you have EPS self-compacting. There are a lot of technologies which you can use regarding this building envelope materials. Also, there are many materials like the steel is one important material that will go into the buildings, and you have wood that will go into buildings. You have windows, UPVC windows, aluminum windows, wooden windows and everything. So all these materials should have some recycled content. Recycled content, your steel can be recycled a lot, like from the production, starting from the production. It can be recycled now and then, two times, three times, four times. It can be recycled and reused a lot. And UPVC or aluminum, even these materials will have some recycled content. And when I'm talking about this wood, I'm saying solid versus engineering, and also there are something like MDF boards and all. It is important to choose a proper wood, because if you are using solid wood for everything, then you are going to waste a lot of resources. Like one, it is not easy for a tree to grow. Like it will take 10 years, 12 years, 15 years and all like that. For this wood, we are cutting down the tree like that. Just simply, you'll cut the tree and you'll use that wood. If it is engineered wood, it will save it up to an extent, because it is not solid wood. Engineered wood is something like layers. They will take small layers and they will combine it as a solid wood. And if it is MDF board, that they will have a kind of I don't know how to say that, but particles will be there. So it is a combination of that particles. So try to avoid solid wood, or there is wood called a certified wood, FSC certified wood. You can go for that, so that you will reduce the impact on environment or deforestation. And also, it is good to prefer local materials. Local material in the sense, 300 to 400 kilometers of radius, so that you can avoid the transportation pollution to transport these vehicles to your site. There are a lot of materials which are available locally. So you need not go for some, it's not that you have to use all the material, at least try to maximum extent to minimize the transportation for these materials. And salvaged materials in the sense, in other words, I can say that it is a second-hand material. We call it a second-hand material, already used material, but it can be reused. If you can see this, this is already used one, already used materials. So this one, it can be helped in this way. If you think innovatively, then you can use all the materials which are used in an efficient way. Like if you can see here, you can use this particular things for scaffolding and all, or you can use it as a facade. And here, these are the cycles, scrap cycles, which are there. Very innovatively, they have used it like this. And these are the paint tins which are leftovers, and they have used it as a locker. So it is good to use salvaged materials. This is all about reusing the materials. and waste. This is one major issue that we have in not only in India, in all the all across the world, you are facing this problem. So segregation of waste is very important, because if you are combining both dry and wet waste, then how are you going to treat it? There are a lot of methods where you can treat both wet waste and dry waste. But how are you going to treat if you combine both of them? You have to understand that this is something which has to be started from level of your house. At your house itself, you have to start segregating dry and wet waste separately, so that it will be easy to at least treat that waste. So in waste, actually, there are two types. This is just like I'm giving a basic classification. There are many classifications for waste. That is complicated one. I'll give you simple classification: wet and dry waste. Wet waste in the sense the food waste or the landscape, your garden waste or animal excretions and all. All these can be treated as the wet waste. And dry waste is your paper, glass, plastic, wood. E-waste in the sense electronic waste. All these things should be properly segregated. The first thing is separate wet and dry waste. Then dry can be further separated. And how to handle this waste? How to handle wet waste and dry waste? Wet waste is you can do vermicomposting. You all know this procedure already. So using earthworms, soil and all, you can treat this food waste and all. You can just combine with it, with some soil and all, and in 20 days or 40 days you'll get the manure out. It is very good for land. There are also some, if it is a huge size of project, then there are something called as organic waste converter. So this organic waste, you just have to segregate it properly and dump it into that organic waste converter, and within 24 hours it can be converted into the compost. And dry waste, you can sell it for recycling and all. You can also make money from that dry waste. Many of people are not aware about that. You can sell it and you can get the money as well. And you can also recycle it. You can sell it to recycling vendors. You can reuse if it is possible. If not possible, you can sell it. Now, indoor air, environmental quality. This is something where even now, the PR picture is more, your MEP picture is more in this one. The first thing is daylighting is very important. Just see these two pictures. What do you feel like? So this is having ample daylighting and this is having less daylighting. Which one looks good to your eyes? Which one looks more pleasant? It will definitely be this picture, right? Because this seems like dark room or something uneasy. You will feel something uneasy if the room is dark and gloomy like that. Like your mood will go dark. If it is a very bright place and your mood will be bright. Here I have one more question for you. That is, for daylighting, first I'll tell you, daylighting is important. You have to plan your, you have to design your building in such a way that it gets good daylighting inside, so that you need not use more artificial lighting. And even your artificial lighting should be designed in a way that it should not exceed or it should not go beyond the lux levels required. Lux levels in the sense, the illuminance levels, the light intensity that you need for that particular space. So daylighting and artificial lighting design is very important, especially for daylighting. The openings, all these openings only will bring in the daylight. So it is important to properly design your particular building to get in the daylighting. Here the question is, I'll just launch the poll again. Look at the seventh question. It is recommended, what is the recommended size of opening or glazing? Glazing in the sense, this glass. What is the recommended size? Should it be huge or should it be medium or should it be small, or whether it depends? Huge, medium, small, or whether it depends. You can use your chat box. Please use your chat box to answer. Should the openings, should the window sizes be more or less or medium, or it depends? It depends, depends, depends. Oh, medium, more, Okay. Right. I see that most of the answer is depends. I don't know why did you say that, whether it is a safe answer, or I don't know whether you're really aware whether it depends or not, but the answer is it depends on the type of building. See, if the glazing, if you increase the glazing, it is good in some parameters and it is bad in some parameters. Because yes, of course, if the window sizes are more, the daylighting will be more. I agree on that point. But assume that in Ahmedabad, the temperatures are very high. So if you increase the openings, you are also bringing in lot of heat inside. Glass is one thing where lot of heat and radiation will come into your building directly. So if your openings are more in hotter places, then you are bringing in more heat. Because of that, you have to go for double glazed glass instead of single glazed glass. And you have to use efficient building materials to control that remaining heat. And also you have to increase the tonnage of your air conditioning required inside. Your thermal comfort will be affected. And if you remember in the first slide, you have seen a glass building, which is LEED Platinum rated. But that is totally a glass building. And how is it a efficient building? Because that is in the other country where the climates are very cool. It is in the cold region. So they need more daylighting and heat to come inside to keep themselves warm. So for that particular area, that is a green building. They require more heat to come inside. But for the areas like India, where we have a much hotter climates and all, it is not good to provide more openings. Glass facades are not recommended in areas like this, Ahmedabad or South. Even in South, there is a lot of heat. The areas are very hot. And if you take Kashmir and all, so there the temperatures are very low and they need more openings and more glazing. And they don't need any parameters to be taken care, like increasing HVAC and all. They have to increase heating if proper sunlight or heat is not coming inside. So we have to remember that you have to design it properly according to your climatic conditions and according to the type of building. Also, you can't provide openings on the western side or eastern side as the direct sunlight will come inside. It is good to provide it on north or southern facade so that light will come inside, but not the heat. And ventilation. I'm talking about pressure ventilation. Many people will get confused between ventilation and daylighting. They think that they both are the same, but it is not. Daylighting is something which comes inside even if the windows are closed or it is a fixed glass. But ventilation is something, the open air, the air which comes inside. So the openable area is more important for ventilation. So why I'm talking about fresh air ventilation is, you know, because of this pandemic now, you understand why am I stressing more on this one. But the green building says it is very important even before this pandemic has come. See, the fresh air ventilation is very important because if the people are staying there, the oxygen is very important for us. The fresh air which comes inside is very important. Here I have one more question for you. That is, how many of you feel like you're having headaches or a dizzy feeling when you attend any seminars, sessions, or if you are in crowds? Many people have that. Many people have headaches and just say yes or no. Yes or no in the chat box. Okay, someone is saying yes. Yes, in crowds. In crowds and in closed places, if it is crowded, many people will have this headache and dizzy feelings. Okay, thank you. Thank you for the answers. That is because the carbon dioxide levels will drastically increase. And if that space is not having pressure ventilation, most of the closed systems which are designed previously, they will not have fresh air intake. There is a separate system called AHU unit, which will bring in the fresh air in the centralized air conditioning system. So these are the fresh air supply systems. So like this, you will have the fresh air which is coming inside. Whenever there are crowds, the carbon dioxide levels will drastically go high. And because of that, what happens is, you'll feel dizzy, suffocated, you'll have headaches and all. So the fresh air supply is very important. And if you are having naturally ventilated spaces, that is like where there is no air conditioning. If it is non-air conditioned area, then you can open your windows and get the fresh air inside. Indoor air quality monitoring. So when it comes to non-air conditioned buildings, that is fine because there will be proper system. So your residential areas are and all are fine. But if you consider a commercial space or an office space, or consider your laboratories, college laboratories or seminar halls, something like that, how important is it to monitor your air quality inside? Your air should have a lot of things, like the air is something which you will breathe. If it is not a quality air, then you will face a lot of problems. So you have to ensure that you have the thermal comfort, you have fresh air which is coming inside. It should not be too humid. If there is a lot of humidity inside, then you will feel very suffocated. It will be sticky and irritating for you. And it should be free from pollutions and viruses and all. So you have to take care that you are getting pure air inside. That air quality monitoring is very important. And VOC materials. VOC in the sense volatile organic compound. This is something which will cause you all the irritations. If you can see here, what are the effects of this VOC? So you'll have asthma, itchies. VOC is nothing but I'll just give you a very basic example. If you are painting your room, after the immediate painting of the room or something, you cannot enter into that room. Even if you enter into that room, you'll feel like a sore throat. You'll have a sore throat or you'll get headache because of that smells and all. That is because of volatile organic compound. So you have to make sure that these days you have many premium quality materials, paintings, adhesives, sealants and all these things. They have low volatile organic segment as well. So it is better to choose low volatile organic compound segments. So the VOC value should be less when you're choosing paints, adhesives, sealings or any other materials, chemicals like this. And health and well-being. Health and well-being, it is very important for you. You know why health and well-being is very important. You cannot specifically say that. Even if you're working a lot and all, you just need some breakout for you. So for that reason, it is important that a green building should have facility for breakout as well. So either gym or working space or any sports, something like that. If you are having some breakout spaces where you can chill out, like you can sit outside and relax for a while. In colleges, you'll be having that kind of spaces, right? Like lawns or benches, which are there in some places. You'll be hanging out in that places. That hangout is actually very important for a human being to break out the stress. And differently abled features. Differently abled in the sense the people who have some issues and problems, they can be called as differently abled people. You should not call them physically handicapped and all. That is, banned. You should not call them like that. So these are all the differently abled features. That is, your building should be designed in a universal way so that even the differently abled people can conveniently use it without any help of others. That is, see, if there are only steps, this person cannot go inside with his wheelchair. So if you are having ramp access, your building should have a ramp access at one of the entrances. It is not mandatory that it should be there everywhere, but at least in the one of the entrances, you should have ramp access. And you can provide separate toilet for them with this grab bars. It is difficult for them to get up from their chairs and sit. So there should be grab bars in the toilets. Separate toilet will be there where their wheelchair can directly go inside. It should not have any steps and all. The flooring should be uniform and you can go inside easily and come outside. So, and also the parking facilities which are close to the entrances so that they need not walk for long. And which are close to the lifts or lobby, something like that. These features are very important and very soon they are going to be mandated as well. So it will be a mandatory thing to follow. And finally, I think I've considered all the parameters and here I have another question. I've covered all the features that will go into the green buildings mostly. I think I've covered most of the parameters because I didn't want to complicate this. But here I have one another question for you. Since you have already seen this, I'll launch the poll. Sorry, I did not end the poll. I'm sorry. No, nobody has told me that I did not end the poll. Ah, Mr. Gaurav, you must have told me. Okay, fine. So here, I think I already have the answer. Already have the ninth question. So consider the ninth question. What is the most important feature in green building? What do you think is the most important feature in the green building now? Is it the design? Or what is it? Is it design or is it the energy? Which you are like your HVAC system or energy system that you are planning or designing your building, I mean like architectural design which is going into it, which is more important, or indoor health, indoor environmental quality, which is more important? Can you use the chat box? What do you think is the most important one in this for a green building, especially indoor air quality? All the above. Energy. Okay. All, most of them are saying that it is energy, maybe because all my answers are like all of the above is the most option. Most options are having all of the above as answers. Okay, I'll tell you all of the above. Yes, of course, everything is important for this. It's not just the architect or the design openings and all, and it is not just about the energy. Because energy is something like which can be designed only based on the design. Just I'll tell you an example for that one. If your architect is not designing your building properly, he is giving lot of facades, glass facades. He is using the single, and civil engineer, he is going to use single glazed glass. So there is a lot of heat coming inside. And do you think you'll have any control over HVAC system in that case, if the building envelope is not good? Can you have a control over system? You can't say that the baseline is this, so I will only design up to this one only. So the requirement is 100 tons, but you give only 80 tons because it is the baseline. It depends on the design as well. So only if the design is good, then the HVAC system can be planned properly. And only if both of these are good, the HVAC system, if there is fresh air ventilation and everything, then the indoor air quality will be good. So all these parameters are connected to one another. That is why I said integrated design approach is important. I don't say it is wrong. Most of you said that it is energy. Of course, energy is a major parameter, but everything else is also very important. Water conservation is also important. That is because you are from Ishri and this mechanical background, electrical background. So it is obvious that you will be thinking in that way. That is why I've asked this question. It is not just the energy parameter. It is important to have control over all the parameters, all the design, energy, water, air quality, and everything should be properly maintained. And here is the comparison, just a quick comparison between normal building and a green building. Both of them will be looking the same, and the parameters that will go into the building are same. I mean, the timing controls and all. But even then, because of the measures that you have taken, because since you have planned it properly from the beginning, there will be a lot of difference in the performance. That is, you'll have a good daylighting and ventilation if it is a sustainable building compared to a conventional building. And your systems can be properly sized if you take much care about your building envelope. If your building envelope material is good and it will not bring in a lot of heat, then obviously you will have a lot of energy savings. And if you are installing very good fixtures, water efficient fixtures or something like that, then water savings will be very high if you have treatment plants and all. And if you have good fresh ventilation, the comfort will be good. You will not have the sick building syndrome. Sick building syndrome in the sense it is because of the poor ventilation. Because of that, you will get the sick building syndrome. The air quality will be good, and obviously the operational and maintenance cost will be less since your energy consumption will be less. So these are all the differences between both of them. Now I'll ask a question, a common question to all of them. Now, do you think that designing a green building is something difficult, or you don't understand the green building, or green building is something like a rocket science? Do you think so? Use the chat box, please. I want the maximum answers for this one. No, ma'am. Please use the chat box. No. Even if it is yes, no issues, you can say that. I'll not start the presentation from again, but I'll get in touch with you personally. Achievable. Very good. I feel very happy that at least you might have understood that green building is not a rocket science. It is just a normal building, but it is just about the parameters or the planning that you are doing properly, using it properly and planning it properly will play a major role in a green building. And now it's not difficult for you to achieve a green building. So you have to start somewhere. You can't think that green building is something else. You can start from your end itself. Just you can even turn your home as a green building. It's all about you can replace your lighting fixtures. You can put aerators. You will get that aerators at 100 rupees also. You can put that aerators to your thing. Just use them efficiently. Whatever is there, use them efficiently. Do some plantation. Go for some indoor plants. Air quality, just take care of the air quality. If you're having the windows and all, open the windows and see. Go for star rated. When you're replacing your systems like fans or ACs or refrigerators, something like that, you can go for much better rated systems. So you can start it from yourself. And main important thing is, I stress very much about this in all my sessions, segregation of waste. Please do it and don't waste the power. The consumption of power, like if you are consuming 1 kilowatt here, you are wasting the 3 kilowatts of power which is generated. So it is equal to the generation of 3 kilowatts if you are using 1 kilowatt here. That will cause a lot of carbon emissions into the environment. Just keep this in mind. And even I will talk about your AC. Don't put your AC at 18 degrees, 20 degrees, something like that. I prefer, it is good to put at 24 degrees because that is the very comfortable temperature. You will think that if you are putting it in 18 or 20 will give you cooling, better cooling and all. It's not like that. Even 24 will bring you a better cooling. But just that you have to be patient for 5 minutes or 10 minutes. And you have to understand one more thing, that each degree consumption, I mean, if you reduce it from 24 to 23, there is 3% of energy consumption. For every degree, there is 3% of energy savings or consumption. So just imagine 18 and 24, you are saving almost 20% of the energy if you are putting it in 24 instead of 18. So these kind of things, please take care of all these things. And thank you. Just start somewhere. Just start thinking about this. It is not some rocket science. Part of this, we all have to achieve together. Over to you, Mr. Gaurav. I can take question and answers. I'm happy to take question and answers, whoever have doubts.
Thank you so much. It's an excellent presentation. It was a great session.
Thank you.
As you said, 1 degree campaign. You must have heard about 1 degree campaign. You have stressed about the AC temperature, which you said that it should not be lowered.
Of course, so, we all have to be part of that.
1 degree. And we have Shailendra Bhai, our past president, who started this campaign across the world, I say. Right. He has already joined. Shailendra Bhai, can you have some light about that campaign as well?
Maybe you have to give the access. I have to give the access.
Yeah, let keep him unmute. He's in the participant.
I have
Shailendra Bhai, please give
sir,
him.
Sir is already live.
Okay, fine.
No, I'll not spoil the already built such a wonderful atmosphere, Sandeep Baneji. It was
Thank you, sir.
I was to go for a meeting, but I have postponed it.
Thank you, sir.
It was such an excellent presentation. You made it so simple.
I wanted to keep it simple because the students and many people who doesn't know anything about will attend the session. So if it is in layman language, yes, it will be more convenient to understand what it is.
Okay, thank you, Gaurav and Hardik Bhai. Thanks a lot. But 1 degree was a program of youth. They have initiated it. They have taken it to the world and they deserve all the credit. And thanks for mentioning that 18 and 24 degree difference. It does make a lot of difference. And we can start with just clicking our remote for one more degree.
Within our hands. Very simple job.
Absolutely. So thank you very much, Gaurav. Please take it on. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
So, any questions are there? You can take now.
I think there are questions even in chat box and also in question answer box.
I think you have most of the things you have. What other would have think of you already covered in your session. But is there any questions we can take it?
Yes. What's the different common bricks and what is the difference between common brick and engineering? Common bricks are something which are made with red. It is all about the materials which you are using into it, and the strength will differ. The materials and strength will differ between them. Engineering bricks will have more strength and they'll be more accurate, like in terms of shape and all. It will be convenient. Where I can get green building norms related to building materials in view of HVAC. For sustainable materials, it need not be specifically her HVAC or something. You can get all these materials from internet as well, but you can also log into IGBC or Griha, some kind of these. You can download that kind of rating systems or something. You can get information from that. In internet, you have number of materials available. You have a lot of explanations and comparisons as well. Specifically for HVAC, we can't say anything, because if you are working out well on this building envelope, automatically your HVAC will come down. Your HVAC requirement will come down. So there is nothing specific for HVAC. It is a common and generic one. ABD. Okay. I don't think there are much questions here.
Any
other questions? You can drop in chat box or you can raise your hands. I'm happy to answer. There are two things if there are no questions. Either they did not understand anything or they understood everything. What should I consider?
Possibility number two.
Sir, we panelists will think that way, but... When outside CO2 levels is high, we can take pressure inside and with high CO2 concentration, what is the solution? When outside CO2 level is high and we take pressure inside high concentration, what is this? Okay. So this all depends, sir. I can't say it's, if it is an air conditioned building. If you are talking about a residential building, then I would say inside your building, the atmosphere will be much better. If your particular building is located in a very crowded or polluted area where you feel like a lot of carbon dioxide is there because of the traffic and all outside, then it is not good to open your doors and bring in that particular air inside. But the case is like if you are in a commercial building and if you have a proper right air conditioning system, which the air handling unit, it will handle all these pollutants and it will stop all these things and it will bring in fresh air inside. So the pollution will be very less. We can't say that the carbon dioxide is emissions are because of our human this thing. We emit a lot of carbon dioxide, and of course traffic, because of the traffic and vehicles also you'll have carbon dioxide. But inside the rooms or in the, what do I say, indoors, the carbon dioxide levels can be controlled properly from your proper HVAC system or a ventilation system. If it is residential, it is good that inside indoor temperatures and indoor air quality will be good enough. It won't be a huge problem. Only in commercial buildings, you have to take care about that one. You can recommend our project, this guy. Okay, eco-friendly. Sure, sir. Sure, I can do that. Kiran, sir. Okay. I know him. Yes. And any other questions? Students, I'm expecting more questions from students. District cooling system in India. We are way far ahead from that one, sir. We can try, but it may take a lot of time. It takes a lot of time. Not an easy thing, like even to implement a special kind of cooling system in one single home or villa itself, they're thinking a lot, and I think we need even more a decade to think about these kind of things. What do you say, Mr. Gaurav? You might be having idea on
that. Yeah. Yes. So what I'm going to say that in the GIFT city.
Also in our GIFT city, we have a district cooling system.
Yeah. In the GIFT city, which is the first smart city of the country.
It is one of the largest.
Yes. I've heard about that. Right. It must be very efficient. 10,000 working efficiently. Wow.
Though it is.
I heard about this. Somehow I missed this point. In South, we don't have that, which we have to see.
No issues. We have also planned a visit regularly over there, just before this pandemic. Yeah.
Okay. But I would also like to come there and see how is it working, sir. Because it is not easy to implement such kind of system everywhere. Like, it will take a lot of time for us to implement such things. It's a very innovative thought.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, sorry to interrupt.
The structure of
GIFT City is right here, Mr.
Gaurang. Great. Gaurang Bhai. Gaurang Bhai was the...
I think I am not visible to everyone. Yes.
Gaurang was involved in GIFT City since the beginning.
Wow.
The designing stage and all.
This is really something very innovative. Like, I heard about this long back, sir. It happened few years ago, right? How long it has been?
It was like in design and everything was. We started implementing the project in 2013-14, and from 2015 onwards, we were having a full-fledged operations.
Very nice. I would love to see that when I come there. I don't know when will I have chance to come there and see that.
Sure. Most welcome.
Right, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
It must save energy. Okay. No more questions. It must be used to save more energy. Of course, sir. Of course, definitely these kind of systems will save a lot of energy. I think it was done, Mr. Gavro. Maybe question answers. Right.
Yes, Gavro. Okay, thank you, Sandeepni.
Thank you.
Your plan wonderfully since last month, I say that. And it's a really good program. And also many people who joined, who are already working in the field as well, apart from the students. So I'm thankful to you on behalf of the whole team of Ishir Ahmedabad chapter. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.